Welcome to this panel, The Firm and the Law. We are now going to hear a lecture by Charlotte Schmidt-Leonardo. She is a junior professor for criminal law, law of criminal procedure, and interdisciplinary legal research at the University of Bielefeld. Professor Schmidt-Leonardi, we are looking forward to hear your lecture.
Thank you so much. Yeah, so I faced the challenge to keep you interested after having had a great and long day of discussions. My part seems to be the last thing standing between you and your dinner and the conversation with Udi Powell. So I try to be brief, and I'm confident that Katharina Goldberg will ask brilliant questions. So hopefully it will stay interesting for you guys. As many of you know, in Germany, when it came to criminal procedures in the context of white-collar crimes, we tended to see the corporation as a victim, especially in the context of charges of embezzlement. And as cases like the Siemens case forced us to reflect upon this approach, we struggled with the attribution of criminal responsibility for violations closely linked to corporate activities. We seem to understand now that there is no legitimacy in having only individuals bearing the burden of the far-reaching risks under the criminal law. But now in the last years, we tend to overcompensate and intensify pressure on corporations at almost every cost. So where are we now? Well, we are right now in a heavily politicized debate to implement corporate liability into the German criminal law system. We have the coalition agreement of 2018 to implement a form of criminal liability, and we have the 2020 draft of the Verbandssanktionengesetz, which was at the center of the draft legislation to fight corporate crimes, a draft legislation that has been rebranded last year and has now the name of Law for the Strengthening of the Integrity of the Economy. This rebranding was purely a marketing move. The substance is exactly the same, and it goes to show that this law project that has more or less been around since 2013 was rescued and reintroduced and rebranded over and over and still might not be successful. We have about 6 weeks left to see if it will make it to the Committee on Legal Affairs of the Bundestag, and I am not optimistic. In this context, it's maybe interesting to note that in the white-collar crime debate in Germany, traditional fault lines seems to have been completely reversed. Legal commentators and politicians who identify as progressive leftists are calling for additional criminalization, whereas conservatives are advocating a more lenient, hands-off approach. The only consensus seem to be that liability under the Administrative Offense Act, Ordnungswidrigkeitengesetz, is not enough. The current system only provides a regulatory fine of up to 10 million euro for each offense committed by a management level representative, and in addition, the confiscation of proceeds or anything that has been obtained by committing the offense. But this is it. These sanctioning mechanisms are quite modest in their nature and scope. In qualitative terms, they do not allow for harsher penalties like the revocation of operating licenses or the dismantling of corporations. In symbolic terms, and this seems to be very important to a part of the political spectrum at least, the acknowledgement of administrative offenses does not carry the stigma of having done something morally reprehensible, the stigma of blame, of guilt following a conviction, unlike formal criminal punishment. And in quantitative terms, due to the cap at 10 million euros, the financial penalties corporations would face for an identical conduct of their senior management in many other jurisdictions, notably under the US law, let the German liability look ridiculous. The regulatory fines that may be imposed under German law are just a fraction of what other law systems impose. And if we think of the diesel cases, it is obvious why this approach might be viewed as ineffective. Personal guilt will have to be established and proven for every single director, engineer, and software programmer involved in the manipulations. Moreover, the current legal framework in Germany has often been regarded as providing an insufficient deterrent against corporate misconduct, leading to vivid discussions around the introduction of corporate criminal liability that have carried on now for decades. And to put it in the words of former US Attorney General Eric Holder, rephrasing the well-known expression too big to fail, there is no such thing as too big to jail. So nowadays, the German discussion echoes a more pragmatic approach, I would say, that is a little bit less concerned with dogmatic considerations and instead derives the need for effective deterrence against corporate misconduct from the factual economic power wielded by organizations. And there is a lot to be said for this approach politically. We know by now for sure that corporate crimes are real crimes, severe criminal offenses. And we have to move away from the approach to address them as accidents or mere technical glitches. But if the goal is to hold a corporation responsible by the standards of German criminal law, the problem seems to me much more complex than there is no such thing as too big to jail. In my opinion, we tend to overlook that a company at times only provides a criminogenic context. They are managers who, by job hopping on the career path to another employer, take decisions that bring the company short-term profit maximization and are conducive to individual prestige, but that generate medium and long-term risks that over time get condensed into violations of the law. These cases must be separated out. The corporation cannot automatically assume responsibility under criminal law for all offenses of its employees or decision makers. We need to determine when and why the agent's acts are those of the corporation. And from my point of view, at least, we have to take into account the concrete metrics of the corporation, the system per se. We need, in fact, to address the corporate actor and hold it responsible for the crimes that are genuinely the corporate actor's crimes. The argument that is also taken up by the current German coalition agreement that companies should be responsible because, after all, they profit from the wrongdoings of their employees is, in my view, not compelling. The mere fact of being a beneficiary still does not establish perpetration according to established German criminal law. If we do not assume that every corporate crime is the product of the premise profit at almost every cost, then we must be careful to have a complex and differentiated approach, which of course must not be fooled by corporate strategies to manage the message. The 2020 draft, in my opinion, has never been up to the task. It provides for criminal liability if a corporation's senior management commits a criminal or administrative offense, or if the lack of supervision and or control by senior management enables employees to commit offenses. The key provision of the 2020 draft, arguably, is its chapter 3 and 2. It identifies the corporation's fault in selecting and appointing suitable directors to the corporation's senior management as the basis for the liability of the corporation. The approach suggests the traditional concept under corporate criminal law, the attribution model. It ultimately follows the liability model under civil law. However, the model runs counter to a basic condition of sanctioning in criminal law, which is the conversion of the attribution of responsibility and conviction to the same person, basing the penalty on the personal responsibility of the person receiving the sanction. And this is not the case here, because the corporation's responsibility is derived from the management's responsibility. The main assumption here is that the reason for the corporate crime must be organized irresponsibility. This is a very popular catchphrase. And that corporate injustice consists in essence of organizing a corporation in such a deficient manner that criminal conduct is tolerated, facilitated, or even provoked. But as I was saying earlier, I challenge this assumption. From an empirical perspective, I think it's important to discern that the corporation can provide a criminogenic context, which may be caused by group dynamics or maybe a subculture problem. And on the other hand, the corporation may in itself be a criminogenic system with structures that in fact facilitate or provoke crimes, and in this way can be a corporate actor with an equivalent to criminal intentions. But those two phenomena are not the same thing. At least they shouldn't be in that context of criminal law. So in my view, we should try to determine the responsibility of the corporate actor without lapsing into an automatism of attribution due to breach of supervisory duties. Of course, this is challenging because the firm is not a big individual and the categories of criminal law like mens rea are not easily applicable, especially with the different time reality, if you want to say so, the time reality of the corporation. But I think this is the way to go. And in my opinion, it would even be preferable to develop a new normative overall concept and to take corporations, their rights, and their duties as independent actors seriously instead of replicating what is familiar and tailored to humans. In my research, I work on that, on a para-criminal law concept of corporate responsibility. But in any case, I don't think that the 2020 draft is the way to go. And I'd like to conclude with another argument that is made for its attribution model that I'd like to challenge from a normative and strategic perspective. The legislator's argument is that the attribution model is a strong incentive to establish and adhere to compliance management systems, and that we need a little bit of the carrot and stick approach to enforce the law. And the new sanctioning mechanism that includes fines up to 10% of the corporation's annual turnover on top of the deprivation of all proceeds is a really big stick. The aim of the legislator is to initiate an automatic responsibility with the option to mitigate the sentence in the process of concrete sentencing later. So if the corporation is ready to fully collaborate with the authorities, and if the corporation can show that it had or has now implemented a compliance management system, then the sanction can be mitigated. But the draft does not reveal in which cases what kind of compliance will benefit the corporation that is held responsible for the behavior of its management. This entire problem is left to the judge's discretion, who has to take a lot of other parameters into consideration. So from my view, what's important to note is that nothing less than a new bargaining system is about to be implemented. And I'd like to make three final points concerning this. Firstly, concerning compliance systems. The criminological research is quite divided on the question whether or not compliance systems really prevent corporate crimes. By adopting the US approach, which is to mitigate the sentence if there is an investment in compliance, we risk to end up in the US compliance conundrum, as William Laufer puts it. His argument is that companies make compliance expenditures in ways that are now unprecedented because they took the government's bait that they needed to spend and spend and spend more. From his point of view, this means an ineffective and illegitimate escalation in regulatory expenditures. And I think this is a good point for the German discussion. Giving an incentive that is vague might be counterproductive and lead to the approach, let's throw some money at the problem. if the level of law abiding could really be ensured by this strategy, this might be okay, but we are not sure. And in this case, we really have to pay attention to possible inequalities. And this leads me to my two last points. The power game. Today, cases in the US and with some end with some sort of an agreement with the government. Those are DPAs or NPAs. And Germany is, in my opinion, headed towards this system. The concept of a quasi-automatic responsibility and discretion of the prosecution to make deals might lead to an increase of plea deals in Germany. This is not a bad thing per se, because cases like Arthur Anderson in 2002 taught us that traditional criminal procedures with guilty verdicts might have the risk that a few years later, the Supreme Court will reverse the verdict and then there will be no cooperation left. And more importantly, no workforce to benefit from it anymore. But nevertheless, the approach of managing the situation and negotiating a fair deal will be easier if you have a corporate actor that is able to bargain effectively, which means will be able to really have a stand in a subordination system where he could be at the mercy of the prosecutor. And those corporate actors, as you may anticipate, will most likely not be the little firms. And this is my last point. In this context, corporate criminal law may justly ensure accountability and responsibility for some and not for others. This means the equality principle could easily be violated by the discretionary use of law along vague parameters. Because, as demonstrated by the VW procedures, some arguments in favor of mitigating the sentence, like job losses or the impact on share or stakeholders or the economy, will only be made in favor of bigger corporations who can also afford the investment in a compliance system. This means that small, privately held businesses might be subjected to convictions and fines, whereas bigger corporations that impact the economic system might benefit from settlement and non-prosecution agreements. So, in conclusion, unless we are able and willing to address the corporate actor, which means rethinking the system and integrating the corporation as corporate actor sui generis, and unless we are able to discern concrete responsibility that is linked to the corporate actor as such, the problem will not be resolved. But even if we manage to address the corporate actor, we need to keep in mind that we will integrate an actor into our system that is much more complex than the ones the criminal law system is used and equipped to address. So as criminal lawyers, we should ask ourselves the hard question, why we need the criminal law. If it really is to fight corporate criminality, then I think it's worth elaborating a new system that will address those real crimes in a differentiated manner with no exception of for big corporation. If it's more of a symbolic law for the strengthening of the integrity of the economy as conceived right now, I am very skeptical. So we face a lot of predicaments and conundrums at the moment, and I'm looking forward to get inspired by your perspectives on the topic. Thank you for your attention.